There are few rivers in the world never been run. There is one river I've held in my heart for half my life. Now, it's time. Now, it's the Tekeze.
Cock, behind it.
Get a rock. Get a rock.
But I'm getting ahead of myself. This is a story of a group of friends who 20 years ago followed a dream to the highlands of Africa, who sought a treasure of first descents, of discovery, of exploration on the rivers of Ethiopia, who faced death and came back. Bart Henderson, now an Alaska outfitter, survived the whitewater here, but nearly succumbed to hepatitis.
Danger. Danger is something that I don't like to look for. It's something that I don't like to subject myself to.
John Yost, my high school buddy, first river running partner, almost died of malaria.
Rather than thinking about, well, can we really overcome all those handicaps and what are the penalties if things go wrong, we say, this sounds great, let's go do it.
George Fuller, a physician, tropical disease specialist, nearly shot to death in a border dispute here.
The AK-47 don't bother me anymore. Why would they want to shoot you? There's no glory in killing donkeys, you know.
Jim Slade, he was nearly done in by schistosomiasis.
When I was in my 20s, I seriously questioned whether I'd live to see the age of 30, but now that I've passed that milestone a while ago, I have greater faith in my judgment, and I think I'll live to a ripe old age if tropical diseases don't lay me low.
I'm Richard Bangs. I've been involved with adventure travel most of my life, and my real adventures began here.
And at some critical moment, I recognized that I would much rather go forward and try something that hadn't been done before, and perhaps die in this pursuit. And there was a real peace that came with that. There was a sort of liberation with that moment, and I was ready to go forward.
Addis Ababa, the modern capital of an ancient empire. The name translates as New Flower. There's a beauty and grace among the people here that's incredibly inviting. But I've come for the rivers. Here, on the Abyssinian Plateau, the great rivers of Africa are born. 23 years ago, six young men came here to explore these wild rivers. Only five of us could come back. And we bring memories, both rich and sad, of why.
I flew over there on my own. I'd never been to Africa before. I traveled, I flew by myself. I got there, all I had was a phone number.
In 1973, I was 22 years old, and the world was young and exciting.
And I called up the phone number. Of course, we had no money in those days. They just said, yeah, go outside, take the number, whatever it was, 41 bus. And ask somebody when you're at the piazza, get off there, we'll have someone come down there and look for you. And that was it.
I just never forget those first impressions about how wild the place was.
This is where we picked up our fruit, our fresh fruit.
It was said that there was 500,000 prostitutes in the city of Addis in 1973.
Is this our door, or is it the next one?
Didn't you used to live here 23 years ago?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, same ones, I reckon.
What's your name?
This was our home in the early 70s. We were kids then. It hasn't changed much. I wonder about us.
Yes, we used to live upstairs here. And that's the name. Good, how are you?
We divided it up equally.
And how long has she lived here, do you know?
All utilities. Yeah. And a gate guard, that's a bunion. And the use of this to roll our rafts out. We fixed all our rafts and painted the logos. George Fuller painted the crocodile on the side of the boats. This was international headquarters for the birth of international river running. This is where it started.
We were Colorado River runners barely in our 20s. We called our new enterprise Sobek, after the ancient Egyptian crocodile god. Of all the dangers in Africa, we feared most the crocodiles, and we hoped by naming our venture after their deity, they might look kindly on our passage. Whether it was our name, or our logos, or our crocodile handshake, the magic worked. We survived the crocs. In little more than 2 years, we made the first ascents of several major rivers in Ethiopia. We were the first to descend the Awash, the Baro, the Omo, and the most dangerous part of the Blue Nile. No one had done anything like this before us. God, we had fun. We made plans to run the Grand Canyon of Africa, the Tekeze. And we made movies.
Unlike the early African travelers who explored vast expanses of the continent on foot, Sobek chooses a relatively new and unique vehicle for entry into the unknown, the whitewater inflatable raft. This type of raft was specially designed for the rapids of the Colorado River, permitting easy passage into a remote area that would otherwise be inaccessible.
Our gear was primitive, our clothes third hand. We were anything but high tech.
I think we would probably still prefer to do it the way we did it originally, which was to do basic map research and do the absolute minimum in terms of government formalities to be able to get in and out of the country and just go do it.
Colonel Lama, and helicopter Lama Karayat Felganabar.
As trip leader, we're somewhat overwhelmed by all the equipment we're hauling down the river. You know, when we first did these trips, we would have one small dry bag apiece and one bag full of rice and soup and granola, and that would be it.
We're looking at 9,000 pounds of gear and a complete crew of 22.
One more heartache, baby, I can't take it now. My heart is carrying such a heavy load. One more ache would break it. Just like a camel with a heavy back, yeah. One last straw, they say, broke the camel's back.
We'll attempt to travel 220 miles down the Tekeze through the deepest gorge in Africa. The Tekeze divides two provinces that waged a 20-year civil war. We can't tell from the air where the landmines still pepper the river banks, but we can try to figure how dangerous the river itself might be.
Well, we're looking to, you know, get a general feel for whether the water is high or really, really high in flood. We're looking to see if there's gravel bars and beaches that are exposed, to see what the camping will be like. We're looking for a place to set our helicopter down with our enormous amounts of equipment.
You know, we would travel very light. We would throw everything on the top of a country bus, and when we got to the bridge over the river, we'd unload everything, and we'd blow up the boats, and off we'd go. And I think everyone yearns for the simpler times in our lives as we grow older.
We were really in a wild place, so it was exploring in the true sense there. Like we used to always say, welcome to the food chain.
From river bandits to river bacteria, the threat of death was everywhere. There were parasites that caused blindness, bleeding, and death. Crocodiles that showed no fear of man. Rapids that showed no mercy. But we loved it. So, what kept us from coming back? Why would we stay for 23 years? Part of what pushed us away was personal and very painful, still. Mostly, it was political. In 1974, just as we planned to run the Tekeze, Ethiopia was thrown into a revolution and a bloody civil war. Emperor Haile Selassie was deposed in a military coup. Insurrections sprang up. Fighting was factious and fierce. For 20 years, northern Ethiopia was a war zone, and the Tekeze was closed to the outside world. Now, at last, peace has returned to the nation, and we have a chance for another first descent. Time has come today.
That's funny. Pour out one of those big boulders.
What? Did you try to do anything?
Don't try and fight the current. Go with the current.
Locals call it Tekeze Wens, the terrible river. We have no idea what's down there. There is more known about the dark side of the moon than what's at the bottom of the Tekeze Gorge. I get frightened. I wonder about this. I'm sure everybody does. There are things that could go wrong. We've seen them go wrong on many expeditions. This is an area where for years there have been roaming bands of bandits. And what do we do if a group of people show up and they decide just to open fire? In the fist of this violent land, we find temples of peace. Ancient churches carved in caves and alcoves. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church was founded in the 4th century. Faith here is rooted in the rock. At the center of every Coptic church, covered in curtains and shrouded in mystery, is the Holy of Holies, a replica of the Ark of the Covenant. In one of these churches lies the real thing.
You have to take off your shoes and kiss the doorstep and bow before you can go inside.
Stolen from Jerusalem by the son of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba, the Ark of the Covenant, the golden box holding the Ten Commandments, was supposedly carried up the Tekeze. Perhaps somewhere in this canyon we'll find the actual Ark, or perhaps King Solomon's mines. It's easy to dream here.
We expected that the Tekeze was going to be a big, brawny, muscle-bound river.
Looking reasonable.
And we had encounters with rivers in Ethiopia that were bigger than what we were prepared for, and the consequences were dire.
So how big is that gravel bore?
It's 300 feet long, 100 feet wide. It's perfect for helicopters.
While the rest of the expedition was making the long trek to the river, Jim Slade and John Yost were flying in with the gear.
As it came close to departure, we started to read in various news accounts that there were record floods all over the region. So all this sort of pointed to the fact that we might encounter this river after a year of preparation, and it would be in a flood stage that would not be manageable for us. And I had nightmares for days, for weeks, prior to us arriving at the river, thinking that we could find ourselves in a situation that could have disastrous results.
The not so terrible Tekeze. Just like a teacher. Cold and dark.
It feels good.
It feels good. That's rocket on him.
Hey. After 23 years, a million insect bites, dozens of diseases, broken bones and hearts, 9 kids, thousands of river miles around the world, we're back. And now, the Tekeze is ours.
Great to be out on the river finally. This is a long time coming. A lot of planning went in to get this far.
It's beautiful.
Our fears about a river in flood are unfounded. If anything, the river runs low. Just the first of many surprises. Around every bend, we find something new. Things outsiders have never seen.
It looks like some kind of dwelling or something. Yeah. It must have been pretty short, though.
Maybe these guys know.
Could you ask him, Daniel, what this is for, this little place here?
This is to put the ark.
The ark?
The ark of the covenant that they bring from their churches
from
in their
church,
village.
Yeah.
Is this the real ark, or is it the facsimile?
The kikilinya tsillatu no ways. They don't know it. Whether it is the exact or not, but they believe that it's the exact.
They believe it's the real ark.
They believe it's the real ark.
So the tablets of Moses, they believe it's the Ten Commandments. They carry here.
Yeah.
Have they ever looked underneath the cloth?
These young men have great faith, but they know every Ethiopian church has its own Ark of the Covenant.
Not allowed, except the priest.
Only the priest, yeah.
But when pressed again, they say theirs is not the real ark. They say it is hidden in a church not far downriver. So we go searching for the Ark of the Covenant, and searching for something we lost here 23 years ago. It isn't long before we begin to remember our favorite things.
Hey, Slade. Aren't you a little bit too old for this?
For George Fuller, collecting snails and other intermediate host of human parasites is a favorite way to pass the time.
George has always been fascinated by insects and keeps them for scientific purposes. He's the doctor on the trip, but prefers not to be the official trip physician. He just doesn't want to be bothered by that stuff. He's a reluctant physician, I would say. And he's back doing his usual thing, collecting bugs, taking photographs, writing in his tiny script in his little notebook.
Of course, he was with us in 1973, but at that point, he had already been in Ethiopia for quite some time. And so he was sort of the resident expert on the health problems of the wilds of Ethiopia.
Well, and working in hospitals around the world, you know, I found basically most of the diseases in the Western world are very definitely diseases of excess. Eating too much, drinking too much, smoking too much, mostly eating too much while the rest of the world starves. You look at the rest of the world and it has all the diseases of deprivation, you know, not enough sanitation to cut down the disease, you know, not enough food, which exacerbates every illness. Well, we eat too much. The distribution system just doesn't seem to work properly, I don't think.
Not far downriver, George Fuller develops a high fever. By noon, his temperature is 106.
Well, George is sick. George is he's got some unknown affliction that looks to be combination of heat exhaustion and shakes and a fever, maybe a viral infection. Is sometimes coherent and sometimes not. This started last night, I think about the middle of the night or so. I had the chills just a little while ago. And there was a very, very bad cloud burst. He started to shiver violently. We just put him in dry clothes. We wrapped him up in a sleeping bag. He's been dry heaving. But he is a doctor, and he also is a specialist in tropical medicine. And he spent years in Africa treating people. So intellectually, I'm trusting what he says, that this is something that will pass, and it's not as bad as it looks.
One last thing. Dr. Fuller is quite ill.
And he had terrible premonitions about this trip, which he expressed to me, and I talked through with him. And I really thought for a moment there that he might die. And I just desperately didn't want that to happen.
Just, you know, with all this diarrhea and various other things, I don't think malaria is necessary.
In the morning, we try to diagnose the doctor. Is it dysentery, malaria, or something we've never seen before?
I don't know. I mean, it's the more rare of the mosquitoes, but it's the most virulent. It's the one that can kill you in 4 days, if not treated.
As George rests, we're visited by a large group of locals. They're very curious about our gear and heavily armed. It complicates the situation. For everyone's safety, we had to get moving, despite George's condition. Downriver, we faced new dangers. There are more crocs here than we've seen on any river. George is still sick, and now the river is crawling with man-eating crocodiles. Despite the charging crocs, George sleeps a lot as we float downriver.
Let's
rock behind it.
Get a rock. Get a rock, Rich. Got it. I got one.
Watch out, he might come up again.
Good luck stays with us. Hey, yeah. Good health returns. Good sense, however.
George, you feeling better? You look like you're 10 feet off the ground. George, what's the purpose of this climb?
Well, I can get up here and I can look in these little cracks.
We do our own stuff. We read, we sleep, we hunt for bugs. What we do together is talk. Endlessly. We talk about everything. Dangerous places, exotic faces, and weird food. Slade remembers a monitor lizard.
Kind of tough. The wild boar was good, though. We caught the wild boar the same day.
Pretty rich day for food.
Yeah. Well, we caught a lot of fish, too.
On the first Awash trip here, I caught a catfish, and I reached down to cut off the hook. Shock. Threw me back, Knocked my hat off.
A few of those on the own. Well, they really pack a lot.
And how about a hippo barbecue?
It was the third week or something without meat. When we ran to the corner and saw the hippo that had just been speared. Remember that?
That was a wild day.
We all talk about food, but John Yost is a man of action.
There, a lovely rack of lamb. Oh, we need those little chef hats for it, you know?
John has always been full of energy, always been a whirlwind of activity. He's a dynamo in the kitchen. He baked four beautiful loaves of bread last night, and he's always on the go every second.
These are just regular thin-bottom pots, but they have sand in the bottom of them to distribute the heat like an oven. The sand keeps the bread from burning. It actually works better than the Dutch ovens, amazingly enough.
He was always the cook on our early Omo trips, which were our first commercial trips, and he hasn't changed much in 23 years.
Dinner prepared and cooked over the open campfire by the expedition's resident gourmet cook, John, is always a delight, despite its sometimes deceptive appearance.
So, what has changed? Not the food, and not us. Rapids are what we know best. Hundreds of rivers around the world, millions of whitewater miles. If we grew up at all, we grew up here. Both on and off the river, we're always looking for something.
We're hiking up the side canyon. Tallest slope to an area where we sighted with some sort of shelter. What do you think?
Shield your eyes. I think it's the Ark of the Covenant.
The Ark of the Covenant. We joke about it a lot, but this is a world of discovery. And just like in the movies, anything is possible.
Oh, look, there's geese.
Geese is the ancient language of the Ethiopian Bible.
So what does this say?
There are some names, you know. This is Wolekida.
Wolekida?
Wolekida, it's a name.
Uh-huh.
There are personal effects here, but it is unclear to us exactly who or what lives in this cliff dwelling.
No, there's no guide for this. So this has never been seen by outsiders.
Yeah, that's a really wonderful area.
There is a skull and jawbone and other skeletal parts that make us think perhaps it is a burial ground.
Will you ask them what these cliff dwellings are that we just found?
When we return to the river, we find two men from the rebel Agao tribe. They say a monk lives up in these caves.
He told me that it's a monastery, no? He has told me.
And they claim the monk was up there when we were there. That he is invisible.
How many monks?
That he saw us and watched us. That we didn't see him. There is always something watching us. Invisible eyes from invisible monks, bandits around the next bend, the crocs just below the surface, even the white water.
I think you'd want to run this hole anyhow. I think there's a massive little rock there.
up the wall. We can get pretty close to that wall there. I don't think it'll be too much of a problem.
23 years ago, there was a wall in the rapid that still haunts us. A memory still burns. We are miles from the nearest road, but we've never left the information highway. This was my new venture, a webzine called Mungo Park.
We're up and running, Jonathan.
Jonathan, did you download those shots that I...
Where did you get the game?
Oh, you fall into lava. Look what happens when you fall into lava. Here you go, so it's going to fall into the lava here.
With digital stills, video, and audio clips, we are up and running, chatting live on the World Wide Web.
With the internet and the power that it brings, there's a whole new dimension to conveying the emotional richness and the potency of a wilderness experience through the net. And that's why we've sort of encumbered ourselves with all this electronic gear and these accessories.
Can you expect to find anything of consequence other than the adventure and prestige of running the river for the first time?
We hope to find self-worth and the meaning of life.
Yep, I think that should do them.
Potency and power, sure. But also a new way to have fun. On an early morning hike, we meet a villager who is sick and asks for medicine. We're hours from camp and have no antibiotics, but offer to fetch some after a look around his village. He thanks us, and we move on.
What's going on? Coffee ceremony.
All right.
And corn. Corn. Yeah.
Beautiful. Ice cold beer.
Very, very hospitable people.
Ice cold beer.
So this is the side of the Simians that no Westerner ever sees. This is unique.
Not much later, we were told the sick villager died. Here in the highlands, grief runs hot, and our memories come flooding back.
It just makes you think about the deepness of emotion that they're allowed to express here. And we spend so much time, at least in Western culture, trying to avoid. It's a lot more honest, it seems, than what we go through in our rituals.
20 years ago, we felt the sting of death here, not far from the Tekeze.
There are five of us here who have returned to fulfill a dream expressed 23 years ago, to run the Tekeze. But there's one person missing, Lou Greenwald, who was my original partner in Sobek and who also shared this dream.
Lou, who was at a period in his life where he was looking for something different from insurance or whatever he was doing, and he was in Hartford, Connecticut or somewhere like that.
When I met him, he was overweight and he worked at an insurance company. He wasn't happy with his life, but he had this spirit, he had this free soul. Over the next couple of years, I shared with him my idea to come to Ethiopia and run the Blue Nile. That was the most famous river in Ethiopia. And Lou became a stronger person as he went down these rivers, and funnier and more self-assured and a better person. And I witnessed this whole transformation of Lou from when I first met him until the Blue Nile. And he had become an extraordinary human being, I thought. And then suddenly there was this shock that things can go terribly wrong.
When we did the first descent of this section of the Blue Nile, it starts just 100 yards or so below the falls here. That was in 1975. And it was definitely a class 6 section, meaning that there were portages. There are also a lot of class 5 rapids.
We were on the same boat, so obviously I was quite aware of what was happening, and that we were doing something with a boat which we would never do now. We were working with a boat in very serious water with a rope attached to it and people involved, and there's no more dangerous combination. It's the rope that creates the danger, really.
Because it was January and the water was fairly low, we felt the current was slow enough that we can actually push the boat down the side of the wall and get back into the main current that way. And we're actually making quite good progress. But then there was a section of the wall that stuck out just a few inches from the rest of it, and the boat got lodged there right when the boat was in the strongest part of the current. And slowly the boat started to rise up on the wall, and it within a few seconds it became clear that the boat was going to turn over.
I jumped off it and didn't even get my pants wet. I got to shore on a jump.
But then the boat was climbing, and Lou was next, and I was the furthest one away. Lou tried to jump to shore.
Lou just somehow jumped and became entangled in the rope, and it appears that the clip from the jacket caught to it, and so that when we were no longer able to hold the boat to shore, it swept him off downstream in a position where he couldn't fend for himself in the difficult waters.
At this point, I was far enough away, and the boat was going over so quickly at that point that I knew that I was swimming through the rapid myself with the boat. And the boat did turn over. We swam through the rapid. I didn't know myself what was happening with Lou at the time.
Lou Greenwald died.
It wasn't until the next day that we found Lou. He was floating in an eddy, still wearing his life jacket, but the life jacket was pulled up halfway up his head, and he had obviously drowned in that first couple hundred yards. We knew we couldn't carry the body out, so we felt like we had no option but to bury it there. The ground was way too hard to dig any kind of grave, so we just covered him with stones. We built a small fire on top just as a little memorial, and we said our fond goodbyes.
And it was a good time.
I guess this is our covenant, a promise we made to Lou and to each other, to live life as fully as we can, to embrace new places and old friends.
When was the last trip you did with any of us, George? River trip?
Yeah, a long time.
This is our ritual, talking about old trips, planning new ones.
Burma? Looking for rivers in Burma.
I think Burma would be great.
Yeah.
Once they sort out their political problems, we like to wait
Burma's
for
political problems to keep you from going on
a trip. Yeah, we like to wait till the week after the problems are solved.
Sobek's specialty, wait for at least a week after the political problems are solved, and then we jump
at least
in there.
Until the initial landmine sweep is done.
Yeah.
Landmines. As we approach our takeout, a recent battle crossing, the old fear returns. On our last day on the river, we make our way up a small stream and find paradise, and perhaps the Fountain of Youth. Finally, after 23 years, we travel the 221 miles in 18 days down the Tekeze. Maybe time stops when you travel on rivers. It seems like yesterday we first talked about the Tekeze. But this time, the end of the trip feels different. Something has changed. This time, we're coming home to families.
Well, we did it, Ricardo.
All right. One of the last great first.
If we congregated again in 23 years, we'd probably be on a canal trip in the south of France or something.
Rich, just like the old days.
Yeah.
I would love to see that happen.
Bring our kids along to row us.
That's right.
Our grandkids.
Our grandkids. That's right.
But whether or not we can muster up the time and the energy and the monies to get together for another river exploratory, I would say is probably not likely. I think we'd all like it, but I don't know that it's going to happen again.
Whenever you stop doing these sorts of things, you're giving up. There's something about this that brings back, for me, these sorts of memories of childlike discovery, where every corner turned is brand new and every sight and sensation is fresh, and there's excitement in the air. Going home to loved ones brings a sense of exhilaration and relief. But we are who we are, and we can't stop talking about rivers. Probably the five of us have been on this endless pursuit to keep that innocence and approach to life vibrant, alive, and part of our beings. And I think they've all been very rich lives as a result of it. There have been downsides and tragedies, sure. But this quest keeps us charged and engaged and enthused and makes me want to get up in the morning to find out what lies around the next bend.
The Kagan River, Kagan Valley. Oh,